लोग तो हैं पार्टिसिपेंट्स।
वंस द मीटिंग स्टार्ट आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट कि ऑल द पैनलिस्ट काइंडली म्यूट योर स्क्रीन सो दैट नो हिंड्रेंस इन
माइक
द
माइक ये चलते हैं।
Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV Online. This webinar has been brought to you by Kanpur Orthopedic Association and is possible via an unrestricted educational grant from Janssen India, the makers of UltraSet. So I hand over the proceedings to Dr. Ravi Garg, who will take it ahead and introduce everyone today.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Neeraj. I welcome all the panelist speaker, our faculty, Dr. Mukesh Jain, all panelists, Dr. Rajan Nath, Dr. Rajiv Agrawal, Dr. Apoorva Agrawal, Dr. TPS Lamba, and furthermore, Dr. Anup Agrawal and Dr. Kapil Kulsresh. So I would like to start with the welcome notes by our UPA president, Dr. Apoorva Agrawal. I would like to request Dr. welcome our speaker and eminent faculty Dr. Mukesh Jain and our panelist. Thank you.
Thank you, Ravi. Respected seniors and friends, a very good evening to you all. I welcome you all on the behalf of UP Orthopedic Association to this webinar. Kanpur Orthopedic Association has organized a webinar on a very interesting topic, non-union of proximal and distal femur. Dr. Mukesh Jain is a very renowned surgeon and he is the right choice for this topic. I congratulate Dr. Faruqi, Dr. Ravi Garg and all members of the Kanpur Orthopedic Association for organizing this webinar. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Dr. Ravi, now you can conduct the webinar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Apoor. Now I would like to request Dr. Neeraj Saxena to kindly introduce our faculty, Dr. Mukesh Jain, please.
Thank you, Ravi. Good afternoon, friends. It gives me great pleasure and honor to introduce Dr. Mukesh Jain, who is one of the most renowned orthopedicians in our country, especially when it comes to joint replacement surgeries and complex trauma surgeries. Dr. Jain did his post-graduation in orthopedics from India's most prestigious medical college, AIIMS, in early 80s and decided to start his practice in town of Muzaffarnagar. At a time when almost all the AIIMS pass out would be in high demand in the metro cities, Dr. Jain's decision to go to rural township was commendable. Dr. Mukesh Jain has set up Vardhaman Hospital in the city of Muzaffarnagar, which boasted of world's best technology in operating rooms. Patients from all parts of the country and also international patients are traveling to Muzaffarnagar for quality orthopedic treatment. Dr. Jain did his MBBS from Meerut Medical College. He did his MS Orthopedics from AIIMS in 1980 and also did his senior residency from AIIMS. He is a AO Foundation member. He is a life member of Indian Medical Association and Indian Orthopedic Association. He has multiple national and international papers to his credit. He also received prestigious UP Ratan Award from Honorable Governor of Uttar Pradesh in 2002. And he has attended, taught, and conducted many AO courses, innumerable AO courses. So friends, without further ado, I request Dr. Mukesh Jain sir to proceed with his address.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Secretary, and thank you, other colleagues, and especially Dr. Rajanath, who is my teacher. I am going to present today the non-unions of femur. And for that, we have selected two topics. The one is the proximal femur, and other is distal femur. So first, I will start with the proximal femur, and you can ask the questions in between the lecture or after finishing the proximal third femur, and then I start the another one, the distal femur. So the most important thing is that these non-unions in the femur, they are in the different parts and they behave differently. If you take the proximal part, the subtrochantric deformities, these, there are a lot of deforming forces acting on this, so this behave in a different way. If you take the diaphyseal, they are simple non-unions and it is easy to treat them, so we are not discussing the non-unions of the middle fragment. Now coming to the supracondylar region, this is another region where there are a lot of difficulties treating non-unions because of many other reasons. So we will take separately this topic. So once you see a non-union, the most important consideration is what is the local biology, especially in the upper third, the local biology is mostly good. So we have to look for other physiological and systemic risk factors. Fracture of femur are usually managed operatively. Most of the time it is a nail or a plate. So we have to check what went wrong. And when we think about the what went wrong, there are two important things. One is the stability. And for stability, you need a good mechanics, which is always a must. And then you need a good reduction. Once you have a good stability and you restore the anatomy, it always works. The implant is your choice, whether it's a nail or a plate. So two important things is the stability and the reduction. Patient evaluation, yes, you have to ask many questions regarding the nicotinous and SAIDs. Then you can go ahead with the different laboratory screening like serum calcium, vitamin D, TSH, phosphorus, alkaline phosphatase, ESR, and CRP, because many times they carry mild infection if it's not visible clinically. So once you see the non-union, always evaluate what deformity you are carrying. This deformity might be in a different pain, the sagittal pain, frontal pain deformity. You might have axial pain deformity and you can have a rotational deformity in transverse pain. So you have to think about everything, what kind of deformity you are going to manage. So most of the patients, they are usually nailed nowadays. And issues when you see a non-union are always a varus deformity or a flexion deformity, or you may have a limb length disturbance. Then there might be bone defects. There might be large trochanteric starting point, which has a big defect. Then you can have a defect in the head because of the necrosis, because of the constant movement of the implant. There might be neck bone defect. And then on the top of that, you may have the broken implants that may be really challenged to remove them. And then you have to think, because you have to re-implant, so you have to take out everything out of it. Now, how to achieve stability? The environment, it demands stability, not a flexibility. So what you have to do is, very important, load the non-union. And how you can load? You can use compression device. The compression can be axial compression, compression maybe by leg screw compression, or even if you're not getting compression, you can put two screws between distal and proximal fragment that just holds it. It gives it more stability, especially in the non-union cases. We are not talking about the fracture. Second, improve the biomechanical loads. You can reduce all malalignments, correct all type of deformities, and neutralize all the non-compressive forces, whether it's a bending, or it is a shear force, or it is a torsion. Then comes the implant. Implant, you can use combined implants, nail with the plate, or plate with the nail, or you can have fixed angle devices, or you can have larger diameter nails, and then on the top of that, you need an endosteal substitution. Means you have to, if you have a big cavity, if you have a big gap, you can use a non-vascularized fibula or a vascularized fibula. And on the top of that, you have to improve the osteogenesis by adding corticocancerous bone grafts. So these are four important things. Again, repeating, load the non-union, improve your biomechanical loads. Implant is your choice, but you can use different implants for the non-union. And then you have to improve your osteogenesis by adding corticocancerous bone grafts. Now, few surgical tips. Always prepare both the iliac crest and one side of the fibula when you're going to deal a non-union of femur, especially, because you never know what you need inside. Then you need a good size, safe, full thickness incision. And many times you may incorporate periosteum with it so that you have a good vascularity of your skin incision. Then another very important, you have to do 360 degree release of proximal and distal fragment. This is so important that once you release 1.5 inch on both either side of proximal and distal fragment, probably your reduction become much easier. You have not to put more traction or anything, and it become much easier to align your fragments. And once you do it, it becomes so easy after releasing. Otherwise, you keep on struggling. Remove all the fibrous tissue and dead bone in surrounding bone area. Means any fibrous tissue which is not vascular, which is dead tissue, which is a white tissue, it should be removed. And you should see all around that there is some bleeding. So once you see that, it's a red carpet welcome for you. And then you take the medullary canal and always ream it from both sides. Then freshen your both the fragments and open the medullary canals on either side. So these are important tips for every non-union, whether it is a lower limb or it is upper limb. Only important thing that you always prepare both the crest and the fibula. Now, coming to a routine case, if you just see this case, this is a routine you see almost every week you see like this, a broken nail with a varus deformity. So what you have to do is you have to remove implant, you have to do reduction, correct all the deformities, and once you have done it aligned, then in this particular case, we have used intramedullary fibula and we have improved all the mechanical, biomechanical loads. Now, in this particular case, we have selected 95 degree because this is the implant, which is the older implant. And in our hands, we have learned the AO technique in way back in 1986-1987, and we are more trained for this implant, but now this implant is missing from our inventory. But still, I'm using this implant. For me, this is a very good implant. It is as good as a lock plate. Now, choosing this implant to achieve the stability, we have done the implant removal, we have corrected the deformity, and then we have done a fibula, endosteal fibula, to improve the stability. Now, if you just see the, because there was a nail here, so what we did, so we put the fibula just below that so that we can put our blade into the head and neck. Because there was no other implant which was good for this particular fracture, because there is a big hole inside. So it was difficult to go for a nail again. So I decided only option was I could have gone for a longer femoral condylar plate. But I just thought because I like this plate, so we went with this plate and we have chosen this plate and the fibula is below this blade. Now, if you see this, then we have used two or three screws into the proximal fragment. And we have used a longer plate, and we could achieve a very good stability. And in the meantime, we have just taken one screw from the distal fragment to the proximal fragment to achieve more stability. And on the top of that, we have done osteogenesis by bone grafting. Now, this is all. You have seen that it has good union within 3 months' time. Now, this is another case. 48 years female, septocantic proximal diaphyseal fracture. It was treated by reconstruction nail. Again, it is persisting for last 3 months. Non-union is persisting. You can see that the hypertrophy, but it's still the non-union is there. So simple, we have not done anything. We have not used any bone graft. Just put this 95 degree and this tension with the old tension device. And fracture was again loaded by interfragmentary compression. And this is after 6 months. You can see that this is solid bone union, not even using a bone graft in this particular case. Now, this is another lady. She is 44 years old female. It's a good proximal bone stump, but the nail has failed. Reconstruction is possible because you have a good proximal fragment. So we decided again, 95 degree blade paint. And this is after 6 months, fracture almost united. Now, this is a different problem. You see, this patient, she had 3 surgeries already done, and she's in bed for last 2 years. They have attempted different type of nails, plates, everything. Nothing happened. When she came to us, there was a short thing. It was atrophic non-union, and there was a history of bile infection in the past, but at the moment, the wound was completely healed. Clinically, it looks okay. And if you just see, there was a huge void in the trochanter because multiple nails and there was a movement, constant movement. So there's a big hole here. And the entry point is eccentric. this is another very important thing for this particular fracture. That's why the reason you have, and especially nowadays when you're using these nails, which is trochanteric nails, if you're using these nails in subtrochanteric fractures, they are not good. So my suggestion is that never use eccentric nails in subtrochanteric fractures. If you are really using these nails, then your entry point should be more medial. Then only you can align the proximal fragment to the distal fragment. Otherwise, most of the time you will end up with this Verrett's deformity. Now you can see that here, there is again loosening and this nail is lying for the last so many years. Now, what I decided for this, because infection was in my mind, so what I thought that first I should correct the deformity. And what I did, I just closed down this gap. There was a big hole, so we just cemented it so that I could get a fair entry point, central entry point, and I could put this rail in the center. So my Verrett's problem is gone, deformity is gone, and then I added the antibiotic bone cement all around the fracture. Just keeping in mind, if there is a mild infection, I will go in the second stage for the next part. And now, only after a few months back after, what we simply did is we just kept the same nail, the bone is perfectly aligned, and then we put just another plate to it because bone marrow was quite wide, so it was easy to put this plate. And then on the top of that, we did the bone grafting. And this is after 3 months. And then you, after 6 months, you can see that the bone is completely solidified. And the beauty of this was that the patient who was lying in the bed for the last 2 years was able to walk just after the second surgery with them, because there was a nail and there was a plate also, so it was easy to mobilize her early. So this is after 9 months, you can see the fully united bone. This is another situation where you see that the proximal fragment is too small. So it becomes very difficult to hold it by any means. So in such cases, probably what we decided is that we use the fibular plate after doing proper reduction, and we have used two plates, one on the anterior side and another one posterolateral. Because you cannot get many screws into the proximal femur. Many times you get 2 or 3 screws. In this particular case, we got 4 screws. So it looks a little insufficient. So we just added on the anterior side, 2 screws on the proximal fragment and 2 screws on the distal fragment. And this is how it looks. So we could correct the deformity, we could correct the Verrett's, we could correct the rotation, and this fracture united within 6 to 9 months time. Now this is another situation when the fracture has not been reduced properly. Nail is quite loose. So simply what it needs is, it needs a rotational check because the implant was loose and there was the mobility going on. So in such cases, only rotational check is needed. So you can do a, just simply a plating, additional plating, and do the bone grafting. And you can see that after 3 months, 6 months postoperatively, fracture almost united in a year time. With the same implant, with just adding few screws and a plate with a bone graft, it is a wonderful surgery. Another case, where you see that a good proximal stock, it is salvageable, no doubt about it, but patient is 65 years old. It is not good for 95 degrees because there's a big hole already. So it is not possible to put a 95 degree plate. So we decided a different plate, reverse femoral condylar plate in this particular case. All the principles are same, reduction, and then put a bone graft. If you just see this, many times there is a vacuum here. There is no bone graft here because they're already gone. So in this particular case, I just put a bone block on anterior side as well as the posterior side, and hold them with the help of a screw or a threaded wire. And on the top of that, then do your bone grafting. It become much easier, it become much solid in a very early time. And you can see that the fracture is already united in 6 months time. Now, this is another patient where you have to approach in a different way because there was an infection. This patient was 30 years old. DHS was done 6 months back. And this is the position when he came to us. There was a persisting discharge even now. This is the wound. There was a discharge going on, but it's usually 4 to 6 drops every day. So what we did is a total debridement. You can see that, you can see the infection here. So this is all infected. Implant is also a very poor implant. And what we did is we again used the same plate after a complete debridement. We have removed all the bones which were necrotic, and there was a gap. We filled up with the bone beads. It was mixed with antibiotics. And we kept the patient to have his another look after a month. There was no infection. ESRC was normal. Beads were removed. And again, the irrigation done to clean everything. And this is how it looks on after a month. It looks all red. There was no infection, only some tissue which was removed from all sides, cleaned, completely debrided. Stability is the same, the previous plate is still working. And then this is post-operative picture, and this is with the bone graft. And this is, if you see this, so the previous case 9 months back, and this is now after 9 months, a solid union with no infection, patient is back. Because he is young, patient was very difficult to manage this fragment, this fracture. But probably if you have a knowledge of a good debridement, probably it works. And even you can go for a primary fixation in such cases. But for younger surgeon, I would not advise that they should do all these surgeries. They need a very expertise. Then only you can decide to do these surgeries. So this is another patient. She is she's 76 years old. So here something is different because patient is 14 months in the bed. She just came to us and said, "Doctor, I want to walk. Do whatever you want, I want to walk. Make me walk." So for this particular case, we decided the osteoporosis, acetabulum looks okay. We decided to go for a bipolar. And in this particular case, we decided to go for astro. Because the metaphysis was quite good, so I thought the metaphysis fixation would be quite good. So we took her for this process with the bipolar. The acetabulum was good, and on the top of that, because of the non-union, probably I just added another plate so to have a good stability for the non-union also, and on the top of that we did the bone grafting. So this is another case. I mean, you can imagine how bad it is. The nail is out, the trochanter is gone, it is almost smashed, nothing is visible. So but head and neck was not salvageable at all. There was no metaphysical support. So we did a different plan. And when I opened that, I saw that here was a huge metaphysical, posterior metaphysical defect. And there was a hole into the acetabulum. This is a big hole because the screw was going inside last many months. So it has made a big cavity here. So we decided to go for a total hip replacement. And then because there was no metaphysis, so we decided to go for the diaphyseal fixation. And we have used this solution, this TAM, for this particular case. And we just fixed up whatever the trochanter was left with the help of the wires and did the bone grafting here. So this depends upon the age of the patient. Many times you can save the trochanter, you can save the proximal fragment in a younger patient, but in the old age patient, they always come too late. So it is better to provide them a stability and so that they can walk next day. Another similar case, if you see that there is severe proximal bone loss with shortening also, head and neck not visible. I mean, a bit difficult to decide what to do. And again, we decided to go with the S-strong and we did the metaphyseal reconstruction. And then on the top of that, we put a derotation plate also with the bone grafting. And in this particular case, because the acetabulum was very bad, so we decided to go for a total hip replacement. Another case, she is 80 years old, obese, 3 years old, non-union. Acetabulum is eroded. You can see that the screw has already eroded the acetabulum and there is a non-union of the trochanter. Now, in this particular case, again, we have the same option left that we have to go for a diaphyseal fixation with a total hip replacement. I'm just showing this case that many times you may need a trochanter fixation plate and your ulnar plate, Olicronon plate is a very good choice because this has so many screws that you can hold your trochanter very easily and then you can bring into the diaphysis and you can put few screws. So this is another good implant for this purpose. That is particularly I kept this active. Just showing that anytime you are in difficulty, you don't have trochanter plate, bones are quite osteoporosis. You cannot fix the wire. Probably this plate will work. So now I'm teaching you the, this is the initial injury radiograph 2008 when I did it in 2008. And this is a take home message from this lecture. What is I am doing today and what I did in 2008? It's a change. It's a pre-Holy X-ray. Patient came to us and we operated. And this is a post-operative radiograph. I was very happy that I did a good job. And I remained happy even after 7 weeks. I'm doing a good job. Patient is doing a good job. Patient is also happy. And this is after 13 months post-op. It is still not united. It is 2009 post-Holy. He came to me Holy 2008. Now it is 13 months post-Holy 2009. The screws are broken, proximally as well distally. I am still hoping for the dynamization, that there will be natural dynamization will occur one day. But now the patient was having a lot of pain. 13 months passed. So we decided to change. So what I did, post-Holy 2009, I took him again. I thought now we have a very good implant, better than nail. A lot of plates, they came to market and we decided to have this trochanteric plate. And I did a very good job, very satisfied that I have done a wonderful job. Now after 7 months, post-op, pre-Deepavali, 2009, this patient is doing very good. He's happy, I'm happy. Now what happened after 2 days, Diwali? The patient is back to hospital. The plate is broken, fracture is still not united. I thought, okay, let me do it again. And I decided to go for a nail. I'm still very satisfied, I'm doing a good job. But still there is a virus. There is not a proper reduction, if you ask me today. But at that time, it was right for me. And so I was happy that I have done a wonderful job from 2008 to 2010. And now in 2011, after 25 months of post-injury, finally, it looks united. I was not sure whether it will unite or not, but luckily it united. From my side now, I will say it will not unite, but it has united in 25 months with a lot of protection. So the message is, what I could have done that time, I'm doing now. The form, this is a case where you can see this is a 4 months after injury, he came to me. And I just simply put this plate with the same nail, with the same implant, very small surgery, and just added pubic graft. And 3 months after second surgery, the fracture was united. So the message is the fracture should unite between Holi to Diwali. You should not wait for it. You should not wait for second surgery, third surgery. But many times you keep on thinking you have done a good job and you will be successful, but it doesn't happen. So always check what wrong is with your implant. Always criticize your fracture on day one. If you feel the day one that you have not done a good surgery, there is a mild virus or there is some reduction defect, please take to the operation theater to change it again. Within 3 months, your patient will be out of problem. Otherwise, he will keep on waiting Deepavali to Holi, Holi to Deepavali. Thanks a lot. So now, if you want, you can take questions on this lecture.
Sir, when you allow weight bearing in such redos?
I think whenever I'm doing a nail and together, weight bearing is starting from next day.
Okay.
There's no question to stop them because nail is already there to take weight. Nail is a weight bearing implant and on top of that, you have put a derotational plate. So stability is achieved, now patient can walk.
Just one I was thinking, sir, that normally we advise that we should do a larger reaming and put a large diameter nail. But in most of the cases, yes. You have added a plate instead of redoing re-nailing it.
Actually, that is a very good question. That's why I told you what I was doing in 2002, 2003. I'm not doing that. Today, when I see that the bone marrow is quite wide, I will just prefer to add either a fibula or I will keep the nail with it and then I will put a simple plate rather than going for a bigger surgery for three. Yes, you can do that also. There's no question about it. You can do that also. But it is very simple operation.
Yes. Sir, after how many days you remove the cement and redo, or is there any criteria something?
Yeah, see, most of the time, usual time is 4 to 6 weeks time.
4 to 6 weeks.
Again, you culture the second stage. You we, again the culture for
see, the
for
one. Is, yes, you are right. One is the clinical assessment. Many times you open it and still you find that there is some kind of infection or some kind of bad tissue. Yes. Probably in those cases, we just revise it. We again put the bone cement with antibiotic and go back and again wait 4 to 6 weeks and then do the resurgery. We go for the culture, but many times culture doesn't help us more. So it is more of a clinical sense along with the culture.
So how can you assess the intraoperatively that infection is gone fully?
Yeah, you see, it's a red tissue. It's a tissue. Clinically, you can make out. You can see that every tissue looks fine. There is no necrotic tissue around. Once you remove your bone gap, there is no infection. There is no serous discharge. There is no pus. Anytime you have doubt, you can revise the cementing again, and then you can go again. So you cannot say that in one go you will be okay. Many times you have to repeat your surgery twice, thrice.
Okay. Sir, good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Kaise hain Sanjay bhai? Sir, awesome. Nice to see you, sir. It's always a treat to listen to your work. What's your tricks to avoid such virus, which you have shown that you were satisfied that it is good, but what tip can suggest now? While doing nailing, we don't have a virus in the subtrochanteric region.
See, the only important point is your entry point. Your entry point is right. It should not be eccentric. It should be always central, like we used to do for femur nail in the past. See now what has happened, the nail which we're using in the past is gone. Everybody wants to use the eccentric nail, trochanteric entry nail. And that has created more problems for these subtrochanteric fractures. Because you always keep your entry on the periphery, so you always land up with the virus. So always keep in mind that your entry point should be more medial, exactly in the axis of the bone marrow.
With these nails, where you have a little curve, you suggest that we should go for a medial entry.
I prefer for subtrochanteric fracture, not for the trochanteric fracture.
Sir, the Dr. Sanjay Dhawan is asking about the trochanteric entry nails. The trochanteric entry nails, when you reduce the fracture, or bone holding forceps or other maneuver and reaming, the fracture is reduced. Once you put the nail, the forces are so high that the fracture reduction is failed again.
Absolutely right. You see, I'm telling you, even for the trochanteric entry, you go medially.
Okay.
Even for your trochanteric entry, even if you are using a trochanteric nail, even in the trochanteric fracture, and your fracture is extending to the diaphysis, always keep your entry more medially. Then you will not land up with this problem.
Okay.
And sir, any suggestion how to go that medially? How you keep post something or you keep it adapted?
No. See, if you are opening it, then it's very easy.
Yes, sir.
If your fracture is open, then you go from the distal side, retrograde. Not a problem. And if you're treating this patient going from the top, then it is always that you were doing your nails. How you were doing your piriform entry was always the entry. So use a piriform entry.
Once you redo and go from distal to proximal, it always opens in that medial area.
Actually, you have to block something there so that you are at the right place. Like I have shown you one case, especially that there was an eccentric opening. I blocked that by a bone cement.
Yeah.
Once I blocked it, then I went centrally. And you have seen that X-ray was absolutely normal.
Dr. Rajanath, sir, unmute.
I was thinking that more medial entry might jeopardize the vascularity of the head of femur. What is your comment?
Actually, it is not more medial. It is little medial. The word more has not to be there. When you are using a trochanteric nail, you are putting from the tip of the trochanter. But here you are putting the medial side of the trochanter. You are not exactly going more medially, just medial to your previous entry.
So, sir, primarily in subtrochanteric fracture, you can add plate combination can be added.
See, listen,
in primarily case.
See, if your reduction is proper, Yeah. You have not to add anything.
Okay.
The biggest problem is the reduction. Always give more time in reduction. Check your reduction 100 times. Once your reduction is perfect in AP and lateral view, then only you should be allowed to operate.
Okay. Sir, what's your take on these percutaneous encephalitis if you have a long butterfly fragment?
Yes, yes, you can.
Just to add a good reduction. But once you have a good reduction,
you can use circlase wire, but you have not to tie too much. Like we used to do in AO time, when AO started. Nowadays, we want to put percutaneous wire so that we are not hampering any vascularity of the soft tissue. Even in an open case, if it is a huge fragment, you can use your different instrument in a better way, in a softer way, so that you don't disturb the soft tissue and just hold it, don't compress it. Holding is more than enough. So the fragment comes close to your proximal or distal fragment. That's all.
We welcome Dr. Kapil Kulshrest. Dr. Kapil, welcome. Not audible, not audible. Kapil is not audible.
Dr. Kapil?
Sir,
you hear me now?
Yes. welcome, sir.
Welcome, Kapil Kul. Boss. Mukesh sir, do you treat all your now shaft non-unions with the dual fixation, or you have certain rules that I'll go with exchange nailing and a thicker nail in certain cases, and in certain cases I'll go for a dual fixation?
It's very simple. Do you dealing a metaphyseal fracture or you're dealing a diaphyseal fracture? When you're dealing a diaphyseal fracture, stability you can achieve by the help of a bigger nail. So anytime, if I'm dealing a diaphyseal, mid-shaft, I think I will go for a chain nail. But if I'm using the metaphyseal non-union, either distally or proximally, I prefer to add a fibula or to use two implants together.
Fibula will be with plates.
Fibula with plate or fibula? Yes, definitely. Fibula has to be with the plate.
And suppose you are doing bigger reaming and a thicker nail, higher size reaming and nail, would you add bone graft on the same setting or would like to have
I will go for the same setting if bone grafting is needed
in non-union cases, thicker nail and bone graft.
And if you're dealing a simple nail which has been done closed and you see that there is no hypertrophic, there's a hypertrophic union, you can see the callus formation, in these cases you don't need anything. You just exchange a nail with a big nail, give it proper stability. There is no need to open it. There is no need to bone graft.
Sir, can you hear me now?
Yeah. Yes.
Two things. Wonderful presentation. We are facing non-unions in subtrochanteric fracture since ages. Yeah. I think I have seen maximum non-unions in this area, and I am very much afraid. The implant looks good, everything looks good, but it doesn't unite for months. One thing you told, it is varus, which we should not accept. The other thing is, sometimes there is medial comminution, which we often accept. Do you recommend primary bone grafting at the time of first surgery, always, in these cases?
See, it's a very simple thing. If you are doing your first surgery with the comminution, suppose you are doing nail or you are doing a MIPO. If your fragments are close to your fracture, then probably you don't need anything. Because the medial bone gaps, they have a lot of good vascularity. There is a good muscle attachment. But at times in the high-speed injuries, where you feel that the fracture is shattered, probably these are avascular fragments. Yes, in these cases, many times you may need a primary bone grafting. If you feel there is a void on the medial side, then probably, yes, you can do. Otherwise, I don't think you need any bone grafting, the most of the case, as a primary case.
And which is the best implant in your hands for these fractures? BFN or anything?
In my hand, it's still the best is the nail, simple nail. Pyriformis entry is the same nail. I still prefer that thing.
Straight interlocking nail, yeah. Not the trochanteric.
I have done a lot of trochanteric nails. But I have failed many times in reducing it. I feel that is good reduction, but ultimately the actor shows varus. So I decided to go for more medial entry. Then I decided the same nail. Then I thought, why not to go for the older nail? And it gives me better fixation and better correction of the deformity.
With proximal interlocking screw?
Yeah, definitely. You have to use minimum two screws proximally. If you have the space. If you have the space. Yeah.
I think they are the public ones or the...
Yeah, yeah. If you remember, there was a home medical nail. That was one of the best nails. It has a bolt on the top in oblique way, and then it has a transverse screw. That was the best proximal fragment stability by that nail, but that nail is not available now.
Sir, we were not getting it.
Which implant, Dr. Mukesh? Which one?
GK nail. It used to come from GK. When interlocking is started, there was a GK nail was the only nail available.
Roskam.
Which had a locking option from GT to LT. That's what to say.
It's a very solid fixation.
Sir, where are you getting these blade plate at present?
Actually, I have taken a lot of from Jimmer. They had a stock because they were not selling it at all. So I took almost 200 plates from them, and the whole stock is with me. If you want, you can take from me. Anytime anybody wants, can take from me.
Sir, one question is mine. So what is your choice of implant in subtrochanteric fracture? Nail or condylar blade plate? First choice.
See, my first choice will be if the marrow is quite big, then I will prefer to go with the 95 degree.
Okay.
Angle blade. Secondly, for angle blade plate, I need minimum 2 to 3 screws after the blade fixation in the proximal fragment.
Okay.
If I have 2 screws with the blade fixation, I am sure my proximal fragment is stable. Then on the top of that, I will use a longer plate, so that I hold the distal fragment almost another 5-6 screws. So that is the principle, that you use a longer plate and minimum 2 to 3 screws in the proximal fragment. You will, and then you can achieve a very good compression by a compression device. That is the beauty. In the nail, you cannot get a good compression. But in this, you can get a very good compression. And I'm sure the most of the cases, they do very well.
So that means the elderly age group, the white marrow and osteoporosis, you use the condylar blade plate in spite of that nail.
I will prefer a condylar plate.
Okay.
Only thing is the system has changed. Previously, we were more traumatic. Now we are a little softer. So we try to save as much as possible the soft tissue dissection. Make a small dissection and just pass the plate down the soft tissue and then open distally and then put 3-4 screws over there. So that is the only change, otherwise the plate remains same.
Sir, give us some trick about doing per-operative tricks for this blade plate. Because easier said, it's very, very difficult. It's technically demanding surgery. A little mistake will mess up with everything. What's your trick is?
See, the simple trick is that first of all, you should be able to see the trochanter properly, neck properly, and it should be in the right alignment and right axis. Once you have done it, then you find out just above the trochanter, almost half centimeter. Half centimeter above. You just make you put your guide in a reverse manner so that it holds the trochanter also and it holds the shaft also. And when you fit properly, it kisses the bone. You make a mark on the proximal side. So that you have checked your antiversion and you have checked your 95 degree also with that guide. And then you make few holes into that and then you put your guide. And when you're putting your blade into the trochanter, into the neck, then always see on AP and lateral view, keep on moving and keep on checking that you're going in the right direction. Once you go there, the shaft, it comes automatically to the plate. And once it comes, then you can put a device also for compression and then you can put a screws. The only important thing, again telling, that there should be minimum 2 more screws into the proximal fragment. Then only try this plate.
This is on fracture table.
No. You can use it. Without fracture second, table, or you can use the fracture table also.
The second screw in the condylar plate, the first screw rather, just after the blade, should go into the calcar.
No, it won't be able to go to this. It may go
into the calcar. That is what we were told.
It should go into the calcar. But many times, because you are treating these cases secondarily, so you don't know what is the good position for the higher up, or you may be a little lower up, depending upon the bone cavity by the previous implant. So you have to change a little bit up and down, and then your screw definitely should be in the calcar. But at times you may not get into the calcar. You may get the third screw into the calcar or the lesser trochanter. So you are absolutely right. It should be in the calcar. The reason for that is calcar is the most hard, strong bone. So if your screw is there, your stability is more. So, but if you're not getting, then you put the third screw there.
Sir, one question from the audience. How to make a good antibiotic beads?
Yeah, very simple. See, nowadays we are getting what you call it, stimulant. Now I'm not using the bone cement. I'm using the stimulant.
Stimulant.
Stimulant. Stimulant is a simple calcium powder.
Okay.
With a distilled water, 5 ml of distilled water. You take the into a cup, you mix the distilled water into it, and then you put your antibiotic of your choice. The choice of antibiotics is either vancomycin or tobramycin along with gentamicin. Now, for me, I am using vancotobra almost every day in these infected cases. I am showing more of the cases of the non-infected, but we do a lot of non-infected cases. So in this, my routine is that we make the beads. There is a tray. You just mix it up. Only important thing is the antibiotic content should be 4 times what you get in the bone cement antibiotics, like you have a gentamicin beads ready made. They are only for preventive methods. But when you are treating an infection, the antibiotic should be 4 times. So I usually use 2 grams of the vancomycin or 3 vials of the vancomycin along with 3 vials of the tobramycin. I mix it into the same powder in the liquid, and then I put it in over the tray. There are already holes in the beads, like you make different beads for your pulse, etc. So they are available, but with this stimulant, it comes in one package. So you just spread that powder, mixed powder on this plate. The beads are ready within 3-5 minutes and you take it out and you can put them. And they are dissolvable beads. You have not to remove them.
Sir, sometimes we get a constant discharge while using this stimulant in some way.
Yes, you are right. There are allergic reactions.
What my experience is.
Then you are absolutely right. There are allergic reactions, but not much. So once you feel there is a discharge, what usually we do, we go for a second debridement. Again, clean it and again put the same different beads.
But wire has to be removed.
No, there is no wire. These are the simple beads like you put pulse into some pocket.
But stimulant is a very costly affair. It
costs you around 15,000 rupees and another 2,000 rupees for the antibiotic.
Yeah.
But I tell you, these 17,000 rupees will prevent a lot of cost in the past. Okay.
How much gentamicin do you add?
Pardon?
How much gentamicin do you add?
Gentamicin, if I am using Venco with Genta, I am using 3 vials of Venca and 3 vials of gentamicin.
Okay.
In 10 ml. If it is a 5 ml, I will use 2 Venco and 2 Genta.
The advantage with the stimulant is that you need not to remove it.
Yeah.
It goes.
You have high concentration for antibiotic.
So you treat the infected non-union in one stage.
No.
Put the stimulant.
No. I will not. I will put the stimulant. I will divide everything, and depending on the situation, I will put extra fixator on that. I will wait for a month, go again, see if everything is okay, remove the fixator, and put the either you put a plate or you put a nail, depending on the situation. Many times when there is a mild infection, I may go as a primary fixation with the nail, or I can use a cement coated nail also at times, depending upon the patient to patient.
Sir, one question.
Sure.
Is there any commercially available osteogenic protein? Sometimes we get discharge cards from Bombay, Delhi. They have put some osteogenic proteins at the instead of bone graft. What is that? We don't have any access to that.
Actually, I have a very poor experience about any product of stimulating the bones. No one is perfect. And many times you use Kronos or any other type of these products or any protein, and when you open after 6 months, they come out like this.
They
look useless to me. So I'm totally dependent upon my own bone graft.
So one question from the audience. Is the lateral position in normal table is any aid to the reduction in the subtrochanteric fractures?
Many times it helps a lot. It helps a lot. But you see, lateral position is one hanging position, what you use on the lateral table. But I use the lateral position on a small table. So there is a table support. So the table support helps you to maintain the gravity part. So fracture doesn't hang. So it becomes much easier to hold it.
Sir, explain it a little more.
You see, what you can do is, you put your patient in the lateral position. Okay? And you flex your thigh and bring a table, what you call it, a food trolley for the patient, what you have in the room. It's a Mayo's kind of table, which is wooden. That wooden table you keep under thigh and the leg, and then you can check with your CR once you put your limb in the flexion. And that is, for me, I do all my lateral position, nails, anything, the same position for last 35 years. And it is so simple that anybody can do. You don't need any traction. You don't need anything.
You want to say that you will put that wooden frame between two legs?
Yeah. And the upper leg is flexed.
Once you are changing fixator to a nail or plate, do you do in same sitting, or you'll remove fixator in compound fractures or infected cases where you have
gone further?
You'll do in the same sitting or you'll wait?
No, that's a wonderful question. You see, what happens that if you're using a fixator, if your fixator is prolonged, say for more than 3 to 4 weeks time, it is always good that you take out the fixator, keep them in the plaster, only splint for some time, 2 to 3 weeks time, and then go for surgery. But if you are, if your fixator is fresh, within 3 weeks of time, you can go straight away with the surgery.
डॉक्टर लामा साहब, कुछ बात करिए, कुछ पूछिए
जी,
कुछ आप पूछिए डॉक्टर लामा साहब, कुछ बात करिए।
डॉक्टर राजीव अग्रवाल,
आई वांट टू आस्क वन क्वेश्चन, व्हाट इज द रोल ऑफ टेरिपेप्टाइड इन दीज नॉन यूनियंस? After doing proper fixation, do you use peptide or not?
Dr. Rajiv, see, these all things, teriparatide, vitamin D, calcium, yes, definitely most of the patients, they are deficient. They are deficient in vitamin D, they are deficient in calcium. So we don't know the exact role, but definitely all the older patients, those are osteoporotic and have non-union, I prefer to put them on teriparatide in a routine. But I don't know whether they are helping me or I am helping them. I don't
know. Sir, how the one gap non-unions?
Gap non-unions, probably in my next lecture, you will have a very good X-ray. You can see there.
So, one question from the audience. How you decide the antibiotic impregnated nail in an infected non-union? Size of the nail?
You see, I take the thinnest nail. Yeah. Means size 8. For example, if I'm treating a marrow of 11, so I will take a size 8 nail so that I have a good amount of good mantle of the cement all around. So it is always good to have an 8 or 9 size nail and then put a tube around it and then put bone cement to it. And then you take out the tube and your nail is ready.
How to make a good antibiotic nail on the table?
On the table, you can have a tube like you have a there are different tubes available. They are of a thicker diameter, like 12 diameter, 11 diameter. You can ask from the market also. You can ask from the medical company, those who are making your Romvec, etc. They have those tubes. Or many surgeons, they are using these tubes for irrigation or for discharge.
Chest tube.
Yes, so those tubes are quite good. You take these tubes, just put some kind of oil into it, so that they become a little bit, they are not as sticky. And then you put your nail into this and just coat the cement around the nail. And once it is ready, once it is fixed, then by the help of a fresh blade, you cut the hole of the tube. The tube is peeled out, and the nail is ready for you.
Good, good, sir.
Sir, what's your experience?
Sir, one question.
You don't some want to people... in another lecture?
Sir. One question last.
Yeah.
Sir, some people use a condyler plate and make it reverse and in intercondylar as an intercondylar plate.
Yes.
What is your experience?
I have shown you. That's a wonderful plate. But again, you have to have a good fixation in the proximal fragment. If you really ask me the experience, these non-unions many times with the plate are still, they look united. But after a year, they come back with the refracture of the plate. So it is very difficult because it's quite a thick plate. Your assessment is not very good with this plate. But fixation is definitely good.
The chances of errors is there? Any?
No, not at all. If you have put the plate in the right way, no question of errors.
Just one more question. Any experience, because we do get antibiotic nails, pregnant nails inbuilt, already made from Delhi. Do you have any experience or you always use cemented, self-made nails?
See, the important thing is you don't know whether about these nails, what is the quantity of the antibiotic they're using. There has to be 4 times, 3 times antibiotics to be used for the infection point of view. So you're not sure which end. See, antibiotic is again important. If you have a check on culture, probably you can choose your antibiotic. See, antibiotic has to be a stable antibiotic, heat stable antibiotic. So a heat stable antibiotic is only your vancomycin, tobramycin is one of the best antibiotics if you combine with the vancomycin. But you don't know which antibiotic they're using.
Meropenem is also a heat stable antibiotic.
I don't know. I have not used it, but can we use it? We can find out.
I am using it.
That's a new addition to my knowledge. Very good. How much meropenem you're using?
Actually, I am taking the 1% of the cement weight. Yes, 20 gram cement is using a 2 gram of the meropenem. Okay. I am taking.
Thank you. That's a great learning.
Yeah. Sir, now the last lecture, I want to continue your next lecture on the non-union and the distal femur fractures. So you continue this session by your next lecture.
Sure. So the next lecture is for non-union distal femur. So it is the same. Can you see my screen, please? Can you see?
Sir, we are seeing your screen. We are seeing the topic only.
Okay.
Slide was not started.
Do you see now?
No,
sir. You will have to unshare your screen now. I'm unsharing it. And then you share the whole screen, the first thing you have to select. So when you click on share screen, then select the first part, which is called screen. Then you'll be able to share everything, whatever is there on your screen. Yes, now we can see your presentation. You can do slideshow and check once.
Yeah.
ये ऊपर है रिव्यू के बाजू में ऊपर जाइए माउस लेके हाँ लेफ्ट में और लेफ्ट हाँ देखिए स्लाइड शो लिखा है नीचे देखिए स्लाइड शो नहीं हाँ वहां पे भी रिज्यूम स्लाइड शो कीजिए नहीं रिज्यूम स्लाइड शो लिखा है ना देखिए लेफ्ट में नहीं नहीं लेफ्ट में जाइए माउस लेके थोड़ा सा लेफ्ट 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 राइट में चले गए आप हाँ यस यस
इज इट ओके
यस
यू कैन सी ऑल या सो So this is a lecture about the distal femur. So first question to me is why this fracture has not united? Is it a stability or is it a biology, or it is a poor reduction, or it is a wrong implant choice. So any fracture which comes in the non-union, first I look all these four things. And then what are the issues? The issues can be a short distal fragment. It can be a poor bone quality. There might be shortening. There might be varus and extension deformity. There might be broken implants. And there might be associated with the TKR implant, because nowadays TKR is quite common. And these people, the older age group, they have a lot of fractures. So that is another issue with these fractures. So what do we need for a bone to unite? Very simple. You need a good biological environment. You need a balanced mechanical stability. You need a good vascularity. And you need a good host physiology. That is also important. Many times you keep on doing surgeries, but the host physiology is not good and it doesn't unite. So you have to check all these things. Now, what is the solution? The non-union, most of the time, it depends on stability. So load the non-union. And how to load non-union? Do the compression. Compression you can do by axial compression. Compression you can do by the leg through compression. Or if you're not able to do compression, you can just put few screws proximal to distal so that they hold in a better position. And that is called as loading of the non-union. Second important issue is to improve biomechanical loads. How to improve? Correct all the malignment, all the deformities, correct them. Bring them to normal anatomy. Once you neutralize all non-compressive forces, whether it is a bending or shearing or a torsion, always restore your frontal and sagittal plane alignment. Once you do it, it means you have improved your biomechanical loading. The third important choice is your good implant. This good implant means it can be a fixed angle device, it may be larger diameter nail, or it may be combination of two different implants. The fourth important thing, always go if a bone cavity, whether the canal is too big or there is a bone loss, always go for intramedullary substitution. And that is called as endothelial substitution. And that you can do by a non-vascularized fibula, or if you have a plastic surgeon with you, you can go for a fibular, vascularized fibular transplant. And then on the top of that, you need an osteogenesis, and that you can do by adding corticocapsular bone graft. Now, coming to few cases, I will take you from simple cases to difficult cases with non-unions, with gaps. So it is a series of cases which you will see one by one. And everything, the principles remain same, but how to tackle them is more important. Now, if you see, this is a simple fracture. You may call it an intracondylar fracture with more of the metaphyseal combination. Very well done. The first look looks is good, but when you start criticizing, there are a lot of things to criticize. Now, what happened? The plate broken after 3 months. Why it broken? The question comes, what it broken? Why it should have broken? Again, you have to think. First, you think what must have happened. So in this particular case, what went wrong? There is a poor biology. Probably this has been done by an open operation. So the biology is poor. There was already so much combination. And second important thing in this case is a poor mechanics. Why poor mechanics? It should have used a longer plate. If the same fracture, you could have used a BPO with a longer plate, probably this situation could have never occurred. So it looks very good, but there are shortcomings. The shortcoming is a poor biology and a poor mechanics. So what we did simply, revised a longer plate. We need a longer plate and we need a bone graft. Very simple. So this is a simple fracture which simply needs a stability and needs a vascularity, which is osteogenesis, which you have done by a bone graft. And if you just see this fracture after 6 months, it has united. Now coming to another problem. Somebody has done a wonderful job, plate all around. He's happy that you have given him best fixation. But what went wrong? Poor biology. You have taken the periostem from the medial side, you have taken the periostem from the lateral side, and you have put so many screws. So it is a poor concept of additional medial plating in this particular case. There is a poor reduction. If you see there is a flexion deformity. And it is too rigid a fixation. So we are not aligned to unite it. So this concept is wrong. So again, what we did, simply we removed that plate, we took a longer plate, correct the alignment, open the medullary canal, and fix it with a longer plate and bone grafting. So it's simple procedure, very simple. Now, if you see this case, operative distal femur, fracture with nail, with non-union, and it has been dynamized, keeping in the mind that probably it will unite. On day one, you can say it will not unite. But surgeon who has done it, he's hopeful that it will unite. He has done a dynamization. So what happened here? It's a poor implant, this particular fracture, because bone marrow is quite wide. Alignment, you can accept it. But the most important thing here is the coronal shearing. And I tell you, in any X-ray, if you see a coronal displacement, coronal gap, it is a day one failure. If you have a little bit change, a little bit distance in AP view, except possible, it will unite. But in a lateral view, when there is a coronal shearing, any fracture which has a gap between distal and proximal fragment, they are not going to unite. So dynamization was not the answer for these shear fractures. Now simply, because it was a shear injury, so load the shear force by leg screw compression and simply put a longer plate and bone graft, and this fracture, if you just see after 2 months and after 6 months, the fracture is completely united. So whenever you see a coronal plane and a oblique, it is a leg screw, is a much better principle. Now another case, 15-month-old onion fixed with nail. Biology is poor, short nail, poor reduction, wide marrow, and there is a valgus alignment. Not acceptable. It is not going to unite. There is a distraction also. So it is not going to unite. So you can see that reduction is not proper and it is short nail. Now, if you just see this particular case, so what I thought that the removal of nail was a little difficult because it was quite inside. So I decided why not to remain this, with this rim nail. So what I did, I just removed the screws from distal side and I could correct the alignment. And on the top of that, I just put a longer plate with a bone graft. Now you can see the operation has become so simple. You have not to open anything. You have not to open the joint. You have not to open the fracture site. You just good alignment with the just removing the screws and then put a plate and do the bone grafting. And see that after 4 months, the fracture is almost united. So this is a trick that in such cases, because the nail was short, you could have easily used a longer plate with the screws, bicortical screws, and the fracture united. Now this is another case, distal femur fracture with a broken implant. It was a well plated, a good size of the plate was used, but it was a high velocity gunshot injury. So the biology was definitely poor here. So it was expected in any hands that may unite it, may not unite. So there was a poor biology, there was a combination, and there was a wide marrow fracture didn't unite. So what we did simply in these cases, we just aligned, reduced the fracture, put a bone graft with a fibular graft into the medullary cavity, and then graft all around, and then put a longer plate. So very simple. Once you see such kind of non-unions, you just put a fibular graft and a long plate and bone graft, the answer is okay. Now this is after 3 months, this is after 7 months, this is after 11 months, fracture almost, you can see the callus formation united. Now another case, which has a distal femur fracture with implant, 8 months duration non-union. Now you can see that here the lot of bone is missing. There is a huge combination and there is a medial void also. And this is, if you see this, this is not matching here. So the reduction is also poor. So what went wrong? The plate placement is okay, poor. And then there's a poor alignment. There's a poor reduction. It's a poor biology and there's a bone gap. So these are the problems. So we have to take each problem into the account and then treat it accordingly. again, we have used a longer implant. We have corrected everything and again loaded with the fibula because there was a bone gap and put the medial graft and all graft or rather all sides. And this is the follow-up after 10 months. Fracture fully united, if you can see that. The same fracture which had such a bad injury, but you put a fibula here, so you achieve the stability and you put a lot of cracks all around with a longer plate. This is the principle for the non-unions of these fractures. Another case. With this position. So debridement was done. Dead bone was totally removed. Alignment was maintained. Plating was done. And death was filled with the bone cement. Now you may ask why. Because there was a history of infection and there was a lot of dead tissue which I have removed. So I was in dilemma, should I go for a bone grafting straight away or should I wait? Because waiting is not a problem. So you just put a bone block here with the bone cement with the antibiotic and then come back after 4 to 6 weeks time, cement was removed and bone graft was packed. And if you see there's a consolidation in 8 months, which you can see here, it almost consolidated the whole gap. And now you can see the good quality of the bone. Again, the longer plate with a good quality of the bone graft, good distal fixation, good proximal fixation. Again, the same principle. Now, here this patient, 6 months old, non-union. You are asking about the bone gaps, how to manage. You can imagine that this is almost a complete bone gap here, 4 to 6 centimeters. Now, it's a high velocity injury. Poor biology, huge bone gap, and there's a short osteoporotic fragment. So the fixation here is definitely maybe a poor fixation because you hardly have some of the condition. Now what we did again, correction of the all deformities, you can see that everything is aligned properly, proximal and distal fragment in the lateral view, in the AP view. And then again, we put a long fibular graft and we put screws proximally and distally. Many times I fixed this fibula with the help of the K wire or a threaded wire just to keep it more stable so it doesn't move. And then all around it, I put bone cement. Keeping this thing in mind that this will make a good membrane. When I go for bone gap, I get a proper space here. And then after 6 weeks, we remove the cement and did a good bone grafting all around. You can see a good quality of bone graft. And this is after 6 months. Fracture has already started uniting. And here you can see very good solid union. Another case, he came to us 16 months after injury with a non-union. Poor biology, again, poor reduction and a short plate. Again, the same problem and the fracture is in the varus. So when we opened it during surgery, but we saw that there was a complete dead piece, dead bone, almost 2 inches size. You can see this is the whole side, the dead bone. And what we did on the day one, we fixed the plate after alignment, proper alignment. And you can see that fibula, intermedullary fibula, and fixed with the K wire just to hold it in position and then did a bone grafting all around. This is all more than 2.5 inches size, which you can see here. And this is after 4 months and 9 months picture. You can see that the bone has already started uniting. This is another case. Plating was done, fibular grafting was done. It was infected. Later an implant was removed. Infection was healed. It remained in plaster after that for 6 months. Now after 6 months, he has come to us. And now when I opened it, if you just see the first X-ray, I can't make out there will be a shortening. It looks that if the fracture is properly aligned. So simply you have to clean it, you have to debride and fix it. But when we opened it, we removed all the tissue, all necrotic tissue, all fibrous tissue all around. It started pulling down. And there was a huge gap of 4 centimeters. It means there was already 4 centimeter shortening existing. So again, the old fibula, which was already there, it was like dead and it was loose and it was removed. And we again did the same thing. We longer plate after alignment and fixed the fibula inside and because it was almost a more than 4 centimeter gap, a fibula, and then we did a bone grafting all around and if you see these two screws, because they were not put in a position to lag them, so what I simply did it from proximal to distal fragment, I fixed them. So it gives more stability. This is called as loading of the fracture site in such cases. So always load is fracture with screws, either lag screws or simple cortical screws, and then put bone gap, because here the principle is on this stability and osteogenesis. So this is after 6 months, you can see such a wonderful solid fixation. Now this is a very interesting case. This is non-union load third. He came to us with shortening of 1.5 centimeter. I tried to convince that this is not much shortening. You can wear proper shoes with a heel. But he said, doctor, I want my shortening should be corrected with a union. So this was a little challenge for me. I just thought it, and I, what I did, I show you. It was a thin nail visibly and poor distal fixation, shorter nail. And there was a shortening because of the side dynamization, because he was feeling that probably fracture would unite. Most of the time, patient didn't want surgery, and it kept on going shorting. When shorting was too much, then he decided to go for the surgery. Now, what we did is we simply reamed, take out the nail, and we put on a distractor, femoral distractor. And this femoral distractor, we could almost for 1.5 centimeter, we can distract it, and then we put our nail into it. And the medullary cavity was quite wide, so I decided to put a derotational plate on the top of that, so I get a better stability. And you can see that this is a fracture after the distraction with the plate and the nail. You can see the bone gap. Fracture is already showing union. And if you just see here, after a year, it's a complete solidification of the whole thing. This was a quite challenging case. And probably this will help you sometimes if you have a shortening. If you have a distractor, probably you can distract them. You can treat them as a normal case. Now, these are the newer problems coming up for the last 10 years. You have a knee replacement, and then you have a fracture. And the problem here is that most of these patients, they go to the joint replacement surgeon. I will not criticize them, but I will definitely say trauma surgeon is a better surgeon for this. It should be referred to a trauma surgeon rather than a joint surgeon. So these are periprosthetic fracture. It is a second failure. The surgeon has fixed first, and then he tried the second time. It's a poor alignment, poor fixation, and a poor biology. Now what we did is the implant was removed, properly reduced, aligned, and total dead bone was removed. Once it was done, now I wanted to open the medullary canal. It was easy for me to go on the distal part, a simple drill bit, but proximally it was difficult to put the drill bit because I had to break the drill bit. So what I decided that I put a guide wire into it, and then I have a flexible reamer. It was much easier. So for you, this is a tip that in such cases where you cannot ream it, where you cannot drill it, probably this can do a good job. So you can just put your, even if you cannot put from this side, you can put from the proximal side and bring it down, and then put your reamer distal to proximal. So you can ream it so your medullary canal is wide open from both sides. Now you can put the fibula inside, and then you put your plate. The fibula again fixed with the help of the wire, and it was used a long plate. Alignment, if you can see now, the alignment is perfect alignment. Otherwise, there was a flexion deformity, there was extension deformity. And now we have fixed the fibula also with the wire. And now you see that after 1 year, post-op, it is a fully consolidated femur. So these are the few principles which you can use everywhere in the non-union. Another case, only thing, there was a short plate, and if you see these screws, they are simple unicortical screws. So again, the same problem. The joint surgeon has done this plate. So short pain, unicortical, poor fixation. The story was written on day one. It went to non-union. Now when we open it, there was a huge metal reaction. You can see that probably this metal acted in a very funny manner, and the whole dead tissue. So I have to remove each and everything. And then I removed the bone also, you can see that. Then I reduced it, that there was a distraction also. So we kept the length maintained, removed all the dead tissue, removed all the dead bone, and then we just gave, because there was already with the valgus, there was a deformity, so we have to mold our plate accordingly. And we did that. We fixed the plate. We did the bone grafting all around. And you can see that after 9 months, with this such a long plate, with the good fixation, proximal distally, with the bone graft, fracture solidly united. Thank you so much. Stay safe in this corona time. These are my operation theaters, so the latest modern style. And this is our hospital reception. So all of you are invited to see my hospital. We have all facilities. We have auditorium. We have all teaching facilities. Any one of you interesting to come for fellowship, 6 weeks, 2 months. Everything is free. Anybody can come anytime. We have facilities to stay also. We have food facilities. And everything is free for you. Anyone, younger generation, can come to us for any number of days, any number of weeks, any number of months. So you can ask questions. So I finish it with your questions. Stop share. So now it is your turn.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, sir. So nice of you. So complicated and complex non-union cases you have shown. I have never seen these type of cases. You really, I am being obliged to learn a lot of you. Sir, my question, my first question is, how to put fibular graft in proximal and distal segment in where the bone loss is less and there is a window is short? How to put the bone fibular bone graft proximally and distally?
See, the important thing is that this should be quite loose. The graft should be loose. If it is quite thick, it cannot fit into the marrow cavity, or it is tight, then it will become difficult. So what you can do, you can split the fibula so that the fibula in two parts. And for that, you can use a saw. That is one part. And secondly, I told you, a release is very important. The distal release and the proximal release. So with that release, you can take out the fragment out, distally also and proximally also. Once you put your fibula inside on the distal proximal fragment, if you are not able to bring it down, what you can do is you put the whole of the fibula into the proximal fragment with 1 inch left. And in that 1 inch, you can put some kind of wire or K-wire, and then you pull it down so that it goes into the marrow cavity. And then you can keep on pulling, it will keep on coming down. So it should be loose, so it becomes much easier to put it inside of both sides. And for a smaller gap, you don't need a fibula also. That is another thing. For a smaller gap, you can go simply with a cancel bone graft.
Okay, sir.
Dr. Jain, sir.
Yes, sir.
In most of these cases, we ultimately land up into stiff knees. What is your take on that? Can we help on that part also?
See, I tell you, believe it. If patient has come with a full movement to me, he will get full movement from me. If he has come with some lack of the movement, I cannot guarantee for it. But if he has a movement before the surgery, he will definitely going to. If your stability is good, why to put any traction? Why to put any splint? Why to put any slap? Start day one exercises. And you will not believe, I have never seen a stiffness in these cases. They do very well. It is only your dissection and your fixation which is more important, that you should allow early on day one. Patient goes to the ward, immediately he is on CPM or on active exercises. And by second day, I don't use CPM. If there is no pain, I start active exercises. And within 5 days, I give them 90 degree movement with extension almost 5 to 10 degree lag. And thus they get at home gradually and gradually. And within 3-4 months, they come back happily with the full movement.
That is wonderful. Unbelievable, sir. Yeah. In your hands, everything looks so simple.
I know it needs a lot of experience. It needs a lot of experience. It needs a lot of quality surgery. It needs a lot of good fixation, good implant. Everything counts.
No role of cordyceplasty or any case. No role of cordyceplasty is any cases of stiffness.
I will not go as a primary surgery. As a primary surgery, if the patient is already stiff, I'm not going to touch him. My first aim is to give him union. Once his union is there, he's ready to walk. He's very happy. Now after 6 months he comes. Sir, movement bhi de dijiye thoda sa. Then probably I will go for an arthroscopic release or an open release. And then we try to provide him 0 to 90 days. Not more than that.
Do you use distal femoral nails also? DFNs?
They are out from my inventory. They are out from my inventory. DCS and nail, they are always out from my inventory for last 20 years.
Why? Reasons, sir.
Reason is very simple. The most of the time, the medullary canal is so wide. So it becomes very difficult to hold a non-union. You cannot take a third chance. Patient is already in trouble. Give him the best fixation, but you can do.
Sir, no, I'm not talking of non-union or primary.
Primary, if you're happy, if you have a good quality of bone, good quality of cavity, you can go with the nail. But somehow I don't like. I don't want to open a knee from there. Because it goes non-union, then it goes stiffness, then you remove it, another surgeon remove it, he's in trouble, the patient is in trouble. So better to go outside.
And probably, sir, all the DFNs, they should go up to the lesser trochanter. You should have a longer nail.
Even
if it is done primarily, it should go up.
Fixation is important. Stability is important.
We use short nails and that's why they fail.
You have seen, there are a lot of short nails you have seen.
Yes.
And in that short nail, simply I used a plate on the top of that. Pressure united with 2 3 months.
So any role of dual plating in distal femoral fractures?
Yes, there is indications
of your indications.
Yeah, there is a role. You see, whenever you see a divide on the medial side, medial cortex, in the lower fourth of the femur, probably that is one of the reasons you can use a second plate. Number two, if you have a femoral condyle fracture from the flare, means only the small condyle is available to you, where you cannot have a good fixation distally, then probably that is the second indication. And third indication is for TKR patients, where you have periprosthetic fractures. These fractures are quite osteoporotic. They've already gone for TKR, they walk on this, they're all patients, osteoporotic patients, probably that is one of the best indications where yes, you can use it. Second plate. But for me, a second plate is very, very rare. Only in few cases where I have a medial gap or medial combination in the lower part of the femur.
So one question from the audience.
Sir, sure.
Need of the dual plating, you use the single approach, single midline incision or two separate approach?
You see, if I'm using a plate which I need only in the distal part, probably one incision is enough. But at times you need a plate which has to go a little longer because you are not approaching to the proximal part. So at times you need a second incision also. But most of the time you can do from the primary incision.
In all those non-unions, what's your incision actually?
Incision depends upon the previous. See, if patient is already stiff, incision doesn't matter much. If patient has already having a good movement, then yes, incision should be proper. And most of the time it is a lateral incision. But many times when there is an infection, when there is a scarring, when their quadriceps are totally gone, I may go for a midline incision also at times. And proximally, I will take the lateral incision. Clear?
Dr. Rajana, sir?
Sab log dikh rahe hain.
Actually, sir, we are so much. We are so much impressed and awed by all these cases.
There is some problem with the internet.
Sir, now you will see an influx of young surgeons coming to your center from Kanpur.
Anytime.
Sir, thank you.
Sir, aapko invite young surgeons ko bhi hai ki hum log bhi aa sakte hain?
Kaisi baat karte ho? Aapka ghar hai bhai.
interest.
I have been to your place, sir, many times.
So then you can come anytime. We have all facilities. You're my guest.
सर जब हम लोग पीजी कर रहे थे तब से आपका नाम सुना करते हैं कि कोई मुजफ्फरनगर जैसी जगह में कोई है जहां पे दिल्ली से लोग बाग पेशेंट्स जाते हैं ऑपरेट कराने.
यही मजा है कपिल, कपिल मजा इसी का है, इसी में जिंदा है.
स्टेट ऑफ आर्ट ऑफ वर्क यू आर डूइंग एंड द हॉस्पिटल यू हैव, इट इज एन आई थिंक इट इज एन इट इज लाइक ए मक्का फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस एंड एनीबडी गेट्स अपॉर्चुनिटी टू बी देयर आई थिंक इट इज हिज.
I feel that every orthopedic surgeon in UP, practicing in UP, should visit this center at least once. He will know that how the work should be done and how everything has to be planned. मैं जब पहली बार सर के यहाँ गया था तो मैंने पूछा सर आपके यहाँ general ward नहीं है, तो उन्होंने बोला नहीं, my principle is that every person, कोई भी patient हो उसको अलग ही रखो, he'll feel comfortable and उसको वहीं रखना चाहिए. I think अभी भी वही follow कर रहे हैं सर.
जो क्वालिटी आपके यहाँ है सर वो मतलब इंडिया के लिए बहुत फख्र की बात है सर.
हमारे यूपी वालों के लिए फखर की बात है भाई. हमने सोचा यूपी क्यों बदनाम हो,
तो है ही
है सर. अब तो बहुत साल हो गए सर, 2000 में मैं गया था जब पहली बार सर किया, तो वहाँ आसाम तक से पेशेंट आए हुए थे सर. आई रिमेम्बर तब पूरा मैंने देखा.
मरीज तो यार कहीं भी बेचारा मरता पड़ता आ ही जाता है.
तो आई फील इफ द साइंटिफिक डिस्कशन इज ओवर आई विल जस्ट स्टॉप द स्ट्रीमिंग टू ऑर्थो टीवी एंड देन वी कैन स्टिल कंटिन्यू विद द सोशल डिस्कशन.
I think if any question is remaining, you can ask.
Sir, one question is remaining. Sure, sure. How to avoid the malalignment during plating in the distal femur? Primary procedure, how to, any tips, certain tips to how to avoid the malalignment?
Yeah, I tell you very simple. You see, you should read my article I have written on the lateral plate fixation on the femoral condyle. It is a book which has been published by IOA. So there I have given a complete description how to fix this plate. But for you, the best way is that you should be able to know all the anatomy first. Number one, you should be able to clear all the tissues from the bone except the periosteum, so that you can see the upper limit, you can see the lower limit, you can see the shaft. Once you do that, you put your plate on the distal fragment. Okay? When you put your plate on the distal fragment, you just see where it is kissing.
Okay.
Where it kisses properly, it is neither externally rotated nor internally rotated. It should not rotate. It should be just kissing to the bone. And once you feel that everything is okay, then you put your central screw first. And this central screw should be exactly parallel to the joint line. It should be exactly parallel to the joint, and your shaft and the plate should align. Once you see your shaft anteriorly and posteriorly, it should be centered. Your plate should be centered on that. If you do that, the rest of the job plate will do. This plate is a versatile plate. It's a wonderful plate. It's a panacea for these fractures, the lower femoral condyle plate. If you know how to do it, you can do everything. Just learn it, how to put a plate, how to put a screws. You can really enjoy with this plate. It is so versatile. It's a modular plate, I call it. A surgeon can play with it. Where to put a cortical screw, where to put a long screw, where to put a small screw, where to put a long screw. Anything you can do with this plate.
So you don't use the cortical screws in these plates? You do use cortical screws?
No, it depends. It depends upon, at times if the bone is away from the plate, probably I can use a cortical screw just to pull the plate. But I will not pull it completely. It will be a very balanced pulling. Once I get a good alignment, I will leave it there. And then I put the rest of the screws and the cord, lock screws.
But it's being thought that you should not use a cortical screw once you have put a locking screw. because that may derange your alignment.
That is true. You cannot. That is very right. No, you cannot put a cortical is true after using the logiscule. I'm telling you, cortical is true at times before putting logiscule, that you just you can use as a pulling element.
But or you can first, use a cortical is true. But you are using the first screw is parallel to the joint in the center screw distally. It's always or
absolutely.
So once you have put it there,
that is the most important. If you
once you have already put
once screw, you have put it there, you are okay with it. Yeah.
And then you put a cortical.
Once screw. You have put that screw, it means no. You don't put a cortical. I'm not going to put cortical.
Okay.
Cortical is true in the proximal fragment if it is away from the plate. Not in the distal fragment.
That screw has to
distal
be
fragment. I will again put the second.
That screw, that cortical screw, we put before this screw or after
no,
the
no.
distal screw.
No. If you are using a leg screw, it should be placed before putting the plate. But if you are using a cortical screw as a reduction tool, then you have to put through the plate. Then only you can reduce it.
You have okay, a locking so plate. How can you control the screw to become horizontal? To be parallel to the joint line.
Can you repeat your question, sir?
It is a locking plate. And it is guided by the screw hole. So how can you change the direction to become parallel to the joint line?
So the plate is like this. This femoral condyle plate is like this. That your central screw should go to parallel to the joint line. Parallel to the joint.
It means your
placement of the plate is not.
It is already designed like that.
Yeah.
You don't have to do anything.
Yeah. No. You change your position of the plane. Then the screw will go in a different direction. Yes. Otherwise, it will go into the same direction.
Yes. So you mean to say that if your that screw is parallel to the joint, that means you have placed everything correctly.
Yes.
And if it is not parallel to the joint, everything will go haywire. Right. You need to change it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And one last question, sir. What is your comment on the working length of the plate?
As long as possible. Very simple. Metaphysics to metaphysics.
Okay.
You can use 3 times 2 times. But if you have a longer plate, use the longest plate. For me, it is metaphysics to metaphysics.
Okay.
Especially in the older patient, you don't have a chance for second fracture. If you leave the plate in between, then probably patient may have a fragment in the proximal fragment. So you cover that also. Put a longer plate.
So many times you get the helicopter effect of the plate because of the femoral coxa vara. How to manage with that?
There are two ways. If it is very less, usually it is, if the plate is bigger than 7 holes, then those plates are definitely away from the bone. And in those cases, either you mold your plate, you can mold your plate accordingly, or you leave it as such. Just put your screws away from the bone. No problem. Only thing is, if it is too much, then definitely you have to mold it. Otherwise, it will create little irritation to the patient.
Got it.
You must have seen in one of the cases, I have molded the plate accordingly.
Yes, I saw
so
that.
So that become easier.
Yes.
That was a longer plate. You made a bend.
You can mold
like
the plate accordingly. Yeah. A little bent in that.
So now, any question from the panelist now? Or we should close the session. Dr. Rajiv Agrawal, Dr. Kapil.
I think it was a wonderful presentation.
Yes. Left. Okay. Dr. Very Rajiv Agrawal, any question?
It's okay.
Fine. Very useful to all of us.
Yes, sir.
Very useful to all of us, young and old.
So, okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So many, Dr. Nath, Dr. Ravi, Dr. Kapil, Dr. Sanjay, Dr. Rajiv, Dr. Naman, so many new people I'm seeing. Where is Dr. Lamba? I'm fond of him. He's not visible.
Sir, I am here. Thank you, sir, for a nice presentation.
I would like to thank you all the panelists, Sir Speaker, Dr. Mukesh Jain, for wonderful talks. I have never heard so many cases of non-union or this type of discussion ever
heard from previously in the non-union. So my heartfelt thank you for Dr. Mukesh Jain and all the panelists, Dr. Rajanna sir, Professor Rajanna, Sanjay Dhawan sir, Dr. Lamba sir.
Thank you
Dr.
so much, sir. Thank you a lot. Rajiv sir. Anytime any service for me, I'm there.
Yes, sir. Bilkul, sir. Thank you. One more session will be with you with the elbow and proximal humerus and non-union, sir, in the coming month, sir.
Okay, no problem. Yes. Anytime.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Neeraj, and thank you, Dr. Johnson and Johnson people.